Hebrews chapter 13 and then verse 8. It says, Jesus Christ, the same yesterday and today and forever. Be not carried about with divers or various and strange teachings. For it is a good thing that the heart be established with grace. Somebody say, with grace.
With grace.
What is it with grace that God wants? He wants us to be established in grace. Now, we can know just by the context of the Bible here that grace then is something that's different from just a bunch of teaching. And even just a bunch of good teaching is different than grace. And God says, don't be established in outward things, really. Be established in inward things. Be established in the grace that God gives us. For it's a good thing, the Bible said, that the heart be established with grace, not with meats, which have not profited them, which have been occupied therein. Now, if you know anything kind of about the history of the first 100 years of the church, you know that there was a mighty explosion of the kingdom of God. You know, when John the Baptist came to roll out the red carpet for the Messiah, he said, you know, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. In other words, it's upon us. It's right here. What God's been doing all throughout the Old Testament has been working up to this time. This is what John the Baptist's message was, when God is going to unveil the next part and the most important part of his plan. Really what that was, we know now, it was Jesus coming, and they knew that it would be the Messiah, but they didn't understand, you know, exactly what that would look like. And so they missed him. They didn't expect him to be, for example, born in a manger. And so God coming the way he did was a movement and an act of his grace. It was God's kindness, God's favor, God's power being poured out. And so John the Baptist came, he said, get yourself ready. What's he saying? Get your heart ready, because it's upon us now what God's been doing the whole time. God's been working on it, and he's going to wrap it all up and sew it all up in his own time. You know, God's plan is going to be accomplished. Now, we kind of got in the middle of that, the whole story of the Garden of Eden. We messed things up. Sin entered into the world with our disobedience. We understand that. But God had a plan, and God did not just leave us to ourselves. Aren't you glad? God has a plan in your life today, and even if things aren't going the way that you think they should or prefer that they would, let me just say to you, the grace of God is always available because of the fact that Jesus came and because of what Jesus did in particular at the cross, and more particularly in the resurrection. The resurrection was a time when God's power lifted him up. Grace means power. When the grace of God came up, lifted Jesus up and set mankind free. Are you glad you came to church this morning?
Yes.
So John the Baptist, his message, and we've talked about this a little bit in past weeks, his message was, hey, the kingdom of God is very near. It's right at the door. Repent. Make sure your heart is ready. When Jesus came, Jesus said the same thing. When Jesus came into his ministry, was baptized by John in the River Jordan, the first thing that he said, the sermon really that he preached was, the kingdom of God is at hand. Get ready. God's good at giving us time. Amen? He's good at saying, you know, I'm working with you. You know, God is a good God. This is why the Bible says right here, it is a good thing that you learn how to let your heart be established with his grace, or with his power, or with his favor, or with his kindness, or with what it is that he wants to do in your life. I mean, how can we go wrong by saying, God, do what you want in my life instead of what I want in my life?
Wow.
A lot of times we're running around trying to be happy today, aren't we? Trying to find happiness, trying to find, you know, just something to cause us to be satisfied or content. But the only thing that'll ever do that, we know, we're believers in this room for the most part, the only thing that'll ever do that is Jesus. Not any of the outward things that we could do can, you know, you can have the best wife or husband in the world, but ultimately that will not fulfill that place in your life that's God's place. The only thing that will really fill that, and this is the message today, is the grace of God. I want you to look at another scripture real quick. 2 Peter chapter 5. I started to say there, if you know anything about the background of the church, you know that, you know, not only was there an explosion of the kingdom of God in the first 100 years that rocked the Roman world and changed history, but there's also an explosion of false doctrine and false teaching inside the local churches as they began to grow. Now, what is a church? I want you to stop and ask yourself that today. I want you to think about it. Seems like an obvious answer to kind of a stupid question, really. But I think at the end of today, you might think differently about that. What is a church? A church is a result. Church is not something that we go, okay, we're going to rent that building, the Newtown Meeting Hall over there by the flagpole. We believe God calls us to Newtown, so we're going to find the best building that we can. There's nothing wrong with that. That's part of the practicalities of what we do, but that's not what the church is. We're not going to go meet there on Sundays and even have prayer meetings there on Thursdays. It's not about the formatting and the practicalities. Those things are all important, or we'll just trip over ourselves. I'm not minimizing the importance of planning, preparing for the things that God calls you to do. But a church really is just the result, isn't it? Think about it in the Bible. Jesus introduced the kingdom of God. When Jesus ministered on the planet, what happened? Violent explosions and manifestations of God's kingdom. Are you still glad you came to church this morning? I always want you to be happy at church, right? Come on, man. This is the place to have fun. This is the place to get excited. We can't go out of those doors with big sour pusses on our face. You know, the world will just be like, I don't want to be like them. We've got to be excited and happy. You know, hey, we're getting together for God. What's more important than that? I don't want God. I don't want my will for my life. I want God's will for my life. Make Sunday a greatest day of the week. A chance to come together. And if I can't muster that, if I can't remember that, if I'm having a bad day or an off week like Julie was talking about, then, you know, the thing is, man, somebody else is going to remind me. Alice is going to come up and say, oh, Pastor Rocky, I love your tie today, is what she said to me. And I'm not really a green guy, but I like kind of loud things, so I like the tie. Thank you, Alice. You feel good that maybe I wore the right tie today at least. Who cares about a tie? I can easily just cut the tie off, throw it, leave it in the back room. I don't wear them all the time. Amen? But we just need to be people that find ourselves in God. That's the only place you can find yourself. You've got to find yourself in God. And when we do, that has a way of just showing itself. So when Jesus came, what happened? Explosions of the kingdom of God in real everyday life. Right. Wherever Jesus went, stuff happened. Just think of all the stories. Think of all the, I mean, there's 40 some parables that Jesus told. There's more than 40 just amazing, miraculous things that Jesus did. They're just recorded in the four Gospels. The Bible said if they recorded everything that he did, there wouldn't be any way to contain it in a book. It would take more than one book. It would take so many books. So Jesus did so many things. But he told the people first, and he sent John first saying, get ready for it. It's going to be great. It's going to be mind-blowing. It's going to be awesome. It's going to be like nothing you've ever seen before. Today we go to church and we're not expecting anything to happen, but I'm telling you, we're living in the age. You know, many Bible commentators call it the church age, but really what that means is we're living in the extended age of Jesus.
That's right.
Jesus came, brought the kingdom of God in a new way, a fresh way, a powerful way, introduced true spirituality in the planet Earth, right? And then showed us how to do it, and then said, guys, I'm going to prepare a place for you. Keep up this good work. Church is really just a simple thing. It's just continuing to do what Jesus started. But when we look at ourselves sometimes and then we compare that with Jesus, we're like, whoa, we're kind of, you know, we got a long way to go, don't we? Don't you want to see explosive manifestations of the kingdom of God in your church?
Amen.
The people needed in Newtown. People in Newtown had an explosive manifestation of satanic kingdom. To the point where there's so much, you know, there's so much conjecture about what really happened in Sandy Hook. I mean, you've all seen the YouTubes and things like that. And it's to the point where there's so much confusion about what happened here. Nobody really knows what happened here. Uh-oh, be careful what you talk about. Huh? I'm not bringing that up to make a point out of that. There's so many Christians today that get caught up in that. You know, what's right? What's wrong? What's true? What's false? Hey, what's right is God. What's true is Jesus. He is the way, the truth, and the life. Like the scripture said in Hebrews, man, he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. The one thing I know the Newtown needs is an explosion of Jesus. And that's not just going to happen. It's going to happen through people that follow him. People that believe him. People that trust him. Listen to me today. People that come together around him. When the disciples continued in the book of Acts in your Bible, when they continued to do the things that Jesus did, you know, there's something like 28 chapters of the book of Acts, but it's really just a continuing book still being written today. There's many, many miraculous explosions of the kingdom of God happening all around the earth today. But when his people continued to do that, those first disciples, you see that they continue to have the same results. Isn't that true? They had the same exact kinds of things happen to them. We're going to look a little bit at that. But the point is, churches like the one we're in today, they were just a result of them doing what Jesus did. It wasn't in the mind of God and the purpose of God for Jesus to start churches like we have here. Jesus went into the synagogues or the churches of his time in the Hebrew culture, and he ministered. He also ministered out in the open. He could not be contained, right? But he was equal opportunity. He was speaking the truth to the nation. He was speaking the truth to the religious leaders. Many of the religious leaders got saved. Many of the common people gave their life to the Lord and followed him, embraced him, you know, went with that. And many of them are the people you see in the book of Acts that just continued. But I want you to notice something. They continued in a grace that's different than a lot of what we understand grace to be today. Am I making sense to anybody? There is a grace now in this era that we're living in to get the same results that Jesus had that can only be done one way. And I want you to make a note of it. It can only be done together. A lot of times we read the book of Acts and we're like, oh man, it's just amazing. I mean, and then we make heroes out of each guy. Paul was a great hero of the faith. Peter was a great hero. Him and John. Peter and John went up to the temple in the third chapter of Acts at the hour of prayer, right? And suddenly God was doing something miraculous, and a lame man that was born lame, you know, was healed. And everybody knew that this is something. What, you know what a miracle is? Make a note of it. It's something, it's a divine intervention in the ordinary course of nature. That's what it is. It's when something happens that's just not normal. There's nothing normal about Jesus. There's nothing normal about these people just like me and you that follow Jesus. But they knew one thing that we sometimes fail to understand, and that's this. They understood they had to keep doing it together. And that's what I've been trying to say here. A lot of people teach about the grace of God. And in fact, today, grace has become, in some circles, a heretical teaching. A false doctrine.
Come on.
So even in the teaching of grace, God says, don't let your heart be established in that. It's got to be established in real grace. Anytime in the New Testament you see this phrase, that the power of God was working in them, or the power of God is supposed to be working in you, like Ephesians chapter 3, right at the very end. Anytime you see that, that's grace. It's when God's power comes along, is embraced, captured by a human heart, and begins to work through someone. But a higher grace is when it works through the body. Think about it. If you think I'm kidding you today, think about this. Many of the great miracles or divine interventions into the course of ordinary nature that happened in the book of Acts, they happened because they were together. There's just something about the fact that Jesus is the head and we're the body that God takes very seriously. God never intended for us to do this thing on our own. There are supposed to be the same results. Churches should be a result of those manifestations. But church is a result because it's where people come together.
Amen.
And where people come together, you see Acts chapter 2, explosive things happen. Acts chapter 4, you see the same kind of explosive things happening again. Many of the things that happened out in the streets were the direct result of the things that happened inside the church as they gathered together. They knew that Jesus meant what he said. And when Jesus said, where two or three of you are gathered together in my name, I am there in the midst of you. Today, that's like a Sunday school sermon or a children's church sermon or something like that. Most of the church today lives in a children's church type level. And we get a little angry sometimes if the preacher points it out, right? But I'm just telling you the truth today. You know, the Bible says, study to show yourself approved, that you might be a workman. What's that mean? Somebody who knows who God is and what God's calling you to do. And you might grow in those things step by step by step. You might walk in this grace and power of God. You might know how to do it. There's many instructions in the New Testament letters, you know, that talk about how to maintain the unity when we come together. How to keep out false doctrine. How to make sure that personal conflict does not destroy and divide the church. All these things, all these very important practical things are written down, but they're written down so that the kingdom of God can continue to manifest in the earth. Jesus said in the Lord's Prayer, how many people like the Lord's Prayer? Jesus said in the Lord's Prayer, hey, don't pray like the religious guys do. Remember that? Matthew chapter 6? Don't pray like they pray. What do you mean? He meant don't make a format out of it. Don't make a show out of it. Don't make a religious observance out of it. Don't pray like that. Pray like this. Our Father who is in heaven, your name is awesome, great, and holy. Pray like that. Pray like that today. People look at you, religious people look at you like, you know, what denomination are they? The real one. There aren't any denominations in the Bible. There's only God. There's only the kingdom of God manifesting to the people of God. That there aren't any of the man-made things. If you build your house on man, the Bible clearly says it will be built in vain. If you build it on the sand, it will not weather the storms. That when the rains fall and the floods rise, if it's built on the sand, there's no bedrock, there's no foundation, there's no structure for it to stand on. But the Bible says the structure that we stand on is good. It's really, really good if that structure is God. If that structure is grace. Hello? I want you to know this sermon is so important today. It's so important that you lay a foundation. It's so important that we come back from time to time and make sure that there is a solid foundation in our lives. You can't just assume that I got saved 20 years ago or 10 years ago or whatever, and so I'm still doing good. No, this is a in real time walk with God. You know, this is like we're on Facebook Live now or whatever. I mean, this is in real time. You know, whatever mistakes I make, they're made. I make a lot of them, so trust me, you know. We're not going back to touch them up, to airbrush them out, to do all those kinds of things, you know. We want the real. We want God. We want somebody listening to us somewhere else to have the same opportunity people in this church today have, and that is to be touched by the one true living God. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, forever. What he did yesterday, he's still doing today. He's going to keep doing. Just a matter of, do we believe it? Do we really want the grace? Do we really want the divine intervention? I tell you, there's been some times in my life, I'm sure you could tell me some of your stories too. There's been some times in my life that if it wasn't for the grace of God, I would not be standing here today. There's probably been some times in my life that I'm not aware of that if I had taken advantage of the opportunity for the kingdom of God to explode in my life, I might be further today. How about you? Come on, this is going to start to seep in pretty soon. Just to let the cracks Julie was talking about, just let the little tortoiseshell cracks, but just let them. It's okay to have a few cracks in your life. You don't have to be perfect. We don't, you know, I know we're living in a technologically driven society, you know, but if you're not careful, you know, everything that we think is not real. It's hype. God never used people in the Bible that had perfect makeup.
Come on.
You know? There's not too many Egyptians in the Bible being used by God. Did you notice that? They had some great makeup, the Egyptians did. I'm going to tell you, the Canaanites, the Philistines, those guys had some great makeup. If you go back and just look, you know, do a little research, you're like, wow, those guys. But God used the people that, you know, they didn't always look good. Not everything was in place. And I tell you, it's okay. You don't have to be perfect today. You don't have to be, you don't have to walk around under the common stress of the American culture today that's always telling you got to be something that God never said to you he wanted you to be.
Come on. Amen.
Right? I mean, I'm not going to whiten my teeth to the point of so they look like this just so I can do social media from time to time. It's not going to happen. It wouldn't be wrong if it did happen. If somebody wants to do that, it's fine. But I'm just telling you, it's not necessary, you know. God doesn't use the thing that looks so perfect. In fact, he uses most of the time the ones that don't. It does not seem God would use them. Again, Bethlehem, the manger, they did not see that coming. Who did see it coming? Those that were present. Those that were accounted for. Those that heard the simple voice of God and obeyed the voice of God and just went in the direction. Some shepherds in the field out there. They found the Messiah, man. They weren't even looking for him. They found him. People that, you know, were Bible scholars, were searching and poring over the Old Testament, man. Day after day after day, they missed him. Christians today will argue about everything, divide over every little thing, divide over what we believe, divide over how we look, divide over how we act. None of that stuff is important. I thank God again for all the times in my life I can look back and think, man, God, if not for the grace of God, I would have been somewhere else. If not for the grace of God, I would have never been saved. You know, my story that I told a few weeks ago about having the poster at the foot of my bed. She gave me the Jesus poster, and it was there, but it was surrounded by all the other paraphernalia. All the other things that, you know, young teenage boys have hanging on their bedroom walls. But right in the middle of that, every day I kept seeing Jesus, 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 and it didn't mean a thing to me until about 3 or 4 years later. But what was that? The grace of God. That was a small, unnoticed, divine intervention into the ordinary course of nature. It had not produced anything yet, but it was a seed hanging on my bedroom wall that would produce in time. Do not discount and overlook the day of small beginnings. The little things are the important things. We're doing this on Facebook on Sundays just because there's a lot of people, you know, today that don't have a church like this to go to. And again, when I say a church like this, I'm not saying that we're special. I'm just saying a church with a heart for God. We don't have a lot of things here. You look around, you'll notice that. But one thing that we do have, we have people here that have a heart for the Lord. And when you have that, God can do anything. When you have that, you can end up with a greater result than you would have shot for, than you would have purposed, than you would have worked for. You can end up with God's results. Right. Amen? Let's read a little bit further in Scripture here. First Peter chapter 5. This is one of the great chapters in the Bible, you know. There's so many. What I'm trying to say to you today is that grace is something more than most of us know, than even most of us preachers know. It's something more. And this will be common to studying the Bible. If you haven't studied much, if you haven't poured yourself into the Word of God much, you'll find this is a common thing. You know, there's a surface understanding, and then there's even things God shows you, and they're so cool. And I mean, they're such a blessing. The revelation understanding that God can give you when He shows you things is amazing, but there's no end to the layers of that. And so what you see today can turn into something even greater tomorrow, next year, 10 years from now. It's an amazing thing. There's so many great things in the Word of God. And oftentimes when you take any subject, you see it one way one day, but then as you keep looking into it, it becomes greater and greater and greater. And that's true with grace. Never minimize grace to a doctrine. Grace is an experience. Grace is a walk. Grace is a knowing, okay? It says here in 1 Peter... Now, this is like 63, 64 A.D. when this book was written. So you're like 30 plus years into the church age. And by this time, they've done so many things. The Neros of this world are about to rise up and come directly against the church because of the amazing explosion of spiritual power and energy that it produced in the Roman world. They didn't know what to do about it. So it created a conflict. A lot of times that's what we see in society around us. A lot of times it creates conflict. A lot of times if you stand up a little bit and you start saying, man, I'm excited about the Word. I went down to Connections Church this week. Man, I got excited about that grace message Pastor Rocky was preaching. You know, as soon as you do that, you'll notice conflict. Yep. Conflict will come. Because the enemy cannot afford to have you walking around under the influence of God.
That's right.
That's called grace. Walk around you. A lot of times it's under the influence of God. You read it in places in the Bible like Ephesians 5, and you'll see that sometimes people thought they were drunk. Acts chapter 2. They got under the influence of God, and it seemed like, man, they were so different. People thought they're intoxicated. Fact. If you came to church today and everybody's falling around intoxicated, most people would leave. This is what I'm talking about. You got to look for grace. You can't look for what you know. You got to get your heart set on God so that your heart subconsciously, automatically goes after God. And that's how you protect yourself from delusion. So much deception, so much delusion today. The Bible says it's not going to get better. It's going to get worse. It's going to get so bad. How many people want the bad news today? Listen, the gospel, what's it mean? Almost too good to be true news. That's what it meant. It was a word in the Greek that nobody ever used. There's only two sources that can be found during the days of the writing of the Bible where it was used. Somewhere else in other books. Because it meant it's almost too good to be true. So nobody could use it because there wasn't that much that was almost too good to be true. Even in the Roman Empire. And so that's what that meant, all right? But the bad news is that the delusion, people forgetting how good the good news is going to get so bad as the second coming of Jesus gets closer, as we get deeper into the end times. Listen to me, the Antichrist, the exact opposite of Jesus, is going to sit in the temple and run the show. What? Fact. You know, a lot of times we're like, well, the Jews are going to build a temple in Israel, and that might happen. You know, I mean, they're making plans for that. I'm not discounting that in any way, but Christians are just notorious for doing these dumb kinds of things with their mind. And so that'll all happen. And so it won't be to the Christians. It won't be the church. You know, it'll just be the Jews that experience all that negative stuff. Whew. So Christians do. And by the way, we're going to be raptured. And so just before everything gets really bad, oh man, we'll be taken out of here. Oh man, it's just so good. But be careful. The last days are going to be full of delusion. Is there going to be a catching away? I believe there is going to be a catching away. Is God going to let us experience his wrath? The Bible says no. Okay, but that doesn't mean we're not going to walk through things. That doesn't mean we're not going to walk right up to the doorway of God's wrath. And that doesn't mean that God's, you know, going to always eject us out of everything. Many times he's going to empower us, put the grace of God on us in the middle of something to save other people and help other people. We're better about saving people in the church when things aren't going so well. We are. You know, when things don't go so, I mean, I was here during the things that happened in this town. And I know, man, that we know here in this church, you know, the news outlets and all that, they chase pastors down to find out what we thought about it. And you know, the devil knows most pastors are just like, well, you know, we don't understand everything. Hello? We're just going to, you know, we don't know we're not sure. And, you know, it's just like sissified.
Come on.
Just, you know, the preachers wear dresses. Hello, guys. I mean, if we want the real thing, we got to be real people. And when that happened, they're like, what do you think? And this was my thing. From the very first, we did so many of those different kind of interviews, you know, and I didn't want to make it about anything other than, we didn't want to take away from the negative things that happened here and people that were hurting here. But the one thing that I said that we're going to do every single time to the guy that was with me, that was accompanying me, I said, man, we're going to talk about Jesus every single time. And I remember Anderson Cooper asked me, and some of you saw that, he asked me, he said, you know, what do you do when situations like this happen where there are no answers? What do you tell people? I thought it was an honest question, to be honest with you. And I didn't really think about it. It didn't come from me because, you know, the Bible says, you know, when you get in situations like that, just let God be God.
Right.
Doesn't it? Let him say what he wants to say. So I never really thought about it. I was just thinking, I'm going to try to squeeze Jesus in always, because I know that millions of people are watching this, and this has got to be an opportunity for the Lord. And I remember looking at Anderson Cooper, you know, and later when I went back and looked at it, I could see that it was a divine moment, Julie, like you described, where that little crack, the little opening came in someone's life that I'll probably never talk to him again. I would have never met this guy. But God put me in that position at that moment, and there was open. And because of what happened here, he reflected on what happened in his own personal life about a brother of his that passed away. And he said, I understand what it's like to feel like many people here must be feeling. So what do you say? Other thing I liked about Anderson Cooper is just before we went on the air, he said, hey, whatever you want to talk about, we'll just talk about what you want to talk about. A lot of people don't like Anderson Cooper and whatever. God does. And so that's how I started the interview. Right down there by the Methodist Church. It was so cold outside. Standing there, you know, and it's just frozen. And he just turns to me, just nonchalant, says, whatever you want to talk about, that's what we'll talk about. And I was like, God, that's a lot of responsibility. Right? It's like Anderson Cooper's giving me his job for 2.5 minutes. So I was a little bit prepared for it. And when that happened, I just said, you know, one thing I know in a tough time where there aren't too many answers, one thing I do know, see, that's what preachers need to say. It's not wrong to say we don't know a lot of things. In fact, we got to be honest and we should say that, but you got to follow it up with one thing I do know. Julie, I know you would have loved this one because Julie's so evangelistic. wants to reach people all the time. I just looked at him and I said, one thing I do know, you can always talk to Jesus. We just had a little moment there. It was a little God moment. I just got to be in on, got to witness, got to be around. But I really believe that God wants to do more things like that all over the world. I really believe that, you know, when things out of the ordinary happen that are from the dark side, God's people have to be ready to stand up and to say, okay, we will make a stand for God. We've been standing. The foundation has been being built. We've been learning the ways of grace. We've been being established in these things. And so, Lord, we will follow you. Whatever opening you give to us, whatever option we have, whoever we can talk to, if we just have to go out and just find people, cold call, whatever we have to do, we're willing to do for you. That's what the grace of God is on us for. It says here, Peter said the same thing. I know I never actually got to the reading of it, but notice what it says in verse 9. It says, talking about Satan, resist him steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same afflictions are accomplished in your brothers that are in the world. Knowing that. But the God, somebody say but. But's the biggest little word in the Bible, is it? Come on, Joe, it is. The biggest little word in the Bible. Okay, you're going to have problems. The devil's going to come after you. The verses before, remember, submit to each other. Don't divide from each other. Stay together, guys. Keep the unity of God amongst yourselves. Humble yourselves. Don't swell up in pride. Cast all of your care, your anxiety, your stress upon God. Be sober, be vigilant. Your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, is walking about, seeking whom he may devour. Whom? Resist steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same afflictions are accomplished in your brothers that are in the world. But these are the moments when I love being a preacher. But all that's true. But what? Man, it's right there, isn't it? The God of all grace. See, a lot of people think grace is one of these get out of jail free card type doctrines, teachings, you know. Like I do something wrong and the grace of God, you know, God knew I would do it. And if you're not careful, we don't even have the right heart about it.
That's right.
God does. God did pay for an absolute, right, release from sin. Sin that I committed in the past, sin that I'm going to commit in the future. Everything paid for at the cross. But there's a responsibility that goes along with it, and that is to walk with God. Just keep walking with God. You can't just throw God to the corner and then say, got the grace. That's why this verse is so important. God and grace are interconnected, but the God of all grace. But the God of all grace, who has called us unto his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after you have suffered a little while, that's what the Greek says, just a small space, make you perfect, establish you, strengthen you, and settle you. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Good place to stop the sermon right there. Come on, guys, we need the grace of God. But we need to know that it's available. We need it in a personal way on our lives, but we need it also in this way. And I close with Acts chapter 2. We need it in this way. There's two particular verses in the book of Acts that just blow me away. One's found in Acts 2 and the other's in Acts 4. Peter preaches the gospel. One thing you need to know is that the gospel, the nearly too good to be true news, is equated in the New Testament with grace. It is the gospel of grace. More than one time it's called that way. What's that mean? The gospel, what Paul said in Romans chapter 1, is the power of God unto salvation. To anybody, Jew, Gentile, anybody in any classification, anywhere on planet Earth, the gospel, the almost too good to be true news, is the power or the grace of God. And wherever it's preached, it will work. Let me tell you right now, the gospel, the gospel's happening here. The word of God is being taught and preached here, and the grace of God is automatically available. It's available to you. You might sense God doing something in your life. God might be talking to you about something. It might be something totally unrelated to what we're talking about, but God will do something anytime that his message is preached. Jesus himself was the grace as the messenger. His message carries the same grace. Did I come to the right church today? And so Peter stands up. This is the first opportunity they have to preach that message of the gospel. Basically just the story of Jesus. He announces it. He talks about it. Throws in some scripture from the Old Testament, right, to make some sense out of what he's talking about. In verse 37 it says, "Now when they heard this, they were pricked in their heart and said unto Peter and to the rest of the apostles, Men and brothers, what shall we do?" See, the grace was working. He wasn't even done preaching. And all of a sudden they're like, hey, what do we need to do? What was that? God's the preacher. The Holy Spirit is the one that says, this is what we're going to do today. Okay, Peter, nice job. Good little sermonette. I will take it from here. And he cuts their heart and they answer out. Like people from the congregation are like, hey, stop. No more preaching. I can't take anymore. Need some churches like that. And they said, what do we need to do? What do we have to do? Stop preaching to us about, you know, what it is. Tell us what we do about it. Peter said to them, repent, be baptized, every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ. Okay, so change your mind, change your attitude, change your direction, and sell out to God. That's what it means. In the name of Jesus, for the remission of your sins will be wiped away, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. That's the gift that they had just witnessed that Peter and all the other 120 Christians in the upper room had been hit with. It was a divine explosion of the kingdom of God in the city of Jerusalem that day. Jerusalem was a really, really important place, strategic place. Jesus told them, don't leave this city until you receive this promise. They received the promise. It empowered them, energized them to do what Peter did. And what did he say afterwards? He stood up and he said, you can have the same gift. You can have the same grace. You can be a Peter just like me. You can do what God called you to do. Listen to me here this morning. The call of God is so important. Everything that we're talking about is because the call of God. The call of God. These guys did not know how to do church. They just got saved. Nobody had an outline for how to do church. The most they had was basically what they did in the synagogue, which was not too much different than what we do here. They had a basic little outline, but they didn't know how to do it. But notice the result. Verse 39, for the promises unto you and to your children and to all that are afar off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. And with many other words did he testify and exhort, saying, save yourselves from this perverse generation. The generation is no less perverse today. I mean, after 2 years of an election cycle, we should know that. Is no less perverse out here today. It looks a little cleaner. It's a little bit more sanitized today. It's washed up and combed over and airbrushed out and all that through technology. But it is no less perverse today. Save yourselves. It's the message the church should be carrying. How do you do that? By the almost too good to be true news. Only Jesus can do it. But you can save yourselves if you take his message to heart. And then I want you to just notice quickly what they did. Automatically, nobody told them. Look at what 3,000 people did. They were smarter than us today, who've been doing it for a long time. They gladly received his word. Verse 41, were baptized. The same day, 3,000 people were added to them, and they continued. Somebody say continued. They kept doing what they had been doing. Peter was the one that got their attention, so they kept following Peter and the guys who had been following Jesus. They kept doing it. They didn't stop doing it. They didn't break it up into segments and say, I'll do it on Sunday morning. I'll do it once in a while. They just did it. If you don't have a church to go to that preaches the truth, then you must keep doing it and go find another person and another person and another person. It doesn't matter if you're just two or three. Jesus will gather there with you in the midst of them. But what's important is that when you gather, he's there. His grace will be there. His power will be there. His energy will be there to do what he wants to do. A lot of people sit around and whine today about how bad it is, but they never want to do anything. A lot of Christians sit around and yell the conjecture about this is bad and this, what are we going to do here? And we love knowledge. We love to eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. We love that. But what are we going to do about it? Jesus is what God did about it. We got to keep doing Jesus. How did they keep doing Jesus? Well, they continued in the teaching, verse 42. They continued in fellowship. What's fellowship? That's when you hang out together. They continued breaking bread. That's when you eat together. Something happens when you eat together, you know what I mean? You don't just kind of talk to each other and shake a few hands and give a high five on Sunday morning when Pastor Rocky asks you to. I mean, when you eat together, you start to actually really get to know each other. And it's not that we're always going to be all going to be best friends or anything like that, but we start to get a respect for Jesus is in you, Jesus is in me, Jesus is in you, Jesus is in me. And that's the heart attitude that causes explosions to come from the kingdom of God into our own ordinary everyday life. And we desperately need it today. Oh, and by the way, the fourth thing they did, they kept praying. They set an agenda, a container to stay in that could keep reaching the world. They weren't Jesus individually, but together they were. And so they did it without knowing. It was a heart thing. Their heart got right with God and they automatically started following God. And this is what they did. They stayed in the teaching. They stayed in the hanging out together. They kept eating together and they kept praying together. That's simply what the church is supposed to do. Told you I wind it up here, so I will. But just listen to me right now, please. This is simply what the church is supposed to do. It says, then fear came upon every soul. What's that talking about? It's talking about the reality of God moved in. And people started tangibly being able to get in touch with God. Okay, it was awe-inspiring. It's scary. When you've never done it before, it's a little bit like, oh my God, what's happening here right now? We don't have time to preach on, but you can see that all throughout the Bible. And many wonders and signs were done by the apostles. See, when that happens, that's when that kind of grace moves in and people start touching it and feeling it, then this is what happens. Many signs and wonders start happening. Some people say, well, I go to a church that doesn't believe in signs and wonders. Other people, I go to a church that believes in signs and wonders. I don't care what you believe. It doesn't matter what I believe. It matters what God believes, what God says. God says, let me in, man. I'll do the work. Stop trying to do it for me. Let me in. And all the, it gets crazier before it gets more normal. And all that believed were together and had all things in common. Nobody would do that today. I'm not doing that. We're not sharing bank accounts around here. Hello? I don't know how you handle money. You don't get to write checks out of my bank account. But this grace was so powerful, they didn't even care about that, man. They just went like, whatever. Who cares about my house? Who cares about my money? What? They saw in. The veil was torn when Jesus died on the cross. He said, it's finished. The victory was won. They saw into something greater, something bigger, and they did not care. Today we care. And that's what holds us back. We care about the label. We care. Go to a little church like this one, a lot of people are like, I don't want anybody to know where I go to church. That's your problem. Pastor Rocky. No, we love today in our culture. You want to go to the big church, right? Because that's because you don't have to do anything there. It makes you look successful, but it doesn't mean you're successful in the eyes of God. The only thing that's successful in the eyes of God, whether we're big or small, is whether God's in our midst.
That's right.
That's it. That's the only thing that empowered the early church, and it's the only thing that will empower the church today. They sold their possessions, I mean, they put their money where their mouth was, and their goods, and they distributed them to all men. They weren't dividing the church the way we do. They were dividing their stuff into the church. And they, here's this word again, continuing daily, it was an everyday thing in their life, with one accord in the temple, breaking bread from house to house, did eat their meat with gladness, and simplicity or singleness of heart. It was a heart thing. It wasn't all the outward things they were doing. We look at those and go, how do we do them just the same? We could do the same things they did and not have the same results. But when our heart begins to be like their heart, then the same results of grace will pour into the church. You got to understand, God's way of doing things is called the church. This is what he wants to do. So he'll sit around and wait until we're ready to do it. We want to do it his way. He'll wait for us. He loves us. He wants us to succeed. He's not waiting for us to make a mistake. He's going, come on, let me do it. Will you work with me? Will you give up the things that cause you to not experience the grace of God? Will you give up some of those things? He's not asking a lot. He's really not asking a lot. I mean, Jesus would go away and pray, get away from the crowds. Sometimes he would fast. That's not asking a lot, really, if you think about it. I mean, what's that? A little food, a little time? But we protect that. Right? We're human beings protect. But he gave that away, and when he went back, what happened? God gave him everything. God kept giving him everything. Sometimes Jesus couldn't even walk because of the multitudes, the throngs, man. They were everywhere. They pushed him out. He had to get a boat and preach sometimes. I mean, the amazing things happened. People couldn't get to him, but they found ways to push through the multitude and to get the hem of his garment and to get healing, get free from satanic influence. Whatever they needed, he was the answer. That's grace. Well, I hope you keep the sermon with you for a long, long time. Don't let yourself think the way the world thinks. Paul says in Colossians 2, religion is nothing but the world inside the church. Don't fall for it. Don't fall for it. It's just a way of saying, I do this, I can do that, we can do these rituals and religious observances and rules and regulations, and it'll make us good enough. That's Old Testament stuff. It didn't even work for them. Got him in nothing but trouble over and over and over again. Surely isn't meant for the New Testament church. Don't buy into the world. Don't buy into the culture. Don't buy into what people are saying or thinking. Buy into what God thinks.
That's right.
And I told you I'd get here. This is my last verse. So they continued daily. And you know, when you just look at the next chapter, you see Peter and John went up together to the temple, the hour of prayer. That every day they were doing that and miracles started happening. They continued daily doing all these things that they did automatically. Verse 47 says, praising God, and what's that next word? Having favor. Favor and grace are the same. It's the same word. Praising God, continuing with God, continuing with what God's doing in one another. And they kept doing it and kept doing it. They did it every day. And they started having favor with all the people. And notice what it says here, every day. And the Lord added to the church daily such as should be saved. What that really says is the Lord just kept pouring salvation into the church. He just kept pouring salvation. Salvation is what happens when you're born again, but salvation is also any intervention from God. It's if you're healed, it's if you're sick, healing can come. If you're bound, deliverance can come. If you're a captive, if you're blind, sight can come. That's all. You could be rescued from any situation that you're bound by. All those are in the meaning of the word salvation. As long as they kept doing it God's way, God kept doing it his way in their midst. And that's what we need today. Let's pray. Father, we thank you, Lord. Thank you for your word, God. There's a lot here for us to digest this morning. But Father, I pray for people that are listening both here and in other places. God, I pray that the Spirit of God would just work that transforming work in their life. And Father, work in that grace that empowers and energizes them to follow the call of God. To come together, to become magnetic, Father, with one another. Until the church becomes that thing, Father, that you called it to be. Probably won't be that thing everywhere, but in certain places, in strategic places. Lord, let your remnant of people rise up. Father, with our eyes on you, not on ourselves. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Father God. Listen, if you're here this morning, God's been doing something in your heart. While I've been talking, I just encourage you to let it continue. I don't know everybody. I think everybody's saved. But if you're not saved, this is the best time right now to say, Jesus, forgive me of my sins and come into my life. Be my Lord. Be my Savior. Direct me, guide me, lead me, Lord. You're the great shepherd. I will follow you. That's all you got to do. Got to mean it, but that's all you got to do. If you're not saved this morning, give your life to Jesus right now. I encourage you. I'm compelling you. Urging you. If you've got a situation in your life, listen, you're in the body of Christ today. If you need prayer for anything, we will pray for you. And I guarantee you, God will answer. God will, He is the answer. And so we will help you get a hold of Him. We will get around you and do what the Bible says to do. We'll pray for you. Calling the name of Jesus for you and help you get your answer today. If you need prayer for anything, the altar up here, this open space in the front is going to be open, and we ask you to come and use it. in the name of Jesus. Let's all stand up together.